It is 4:00. I will open the October 7th meeting of the Northampton License Commission. We're missing Commissioner Campidelli today. Commissioner Reel and I constitute quorum. We are audio and video recording the meeting as usual at this time. Is there any public comment on any item not on the agenda or anybody who doesn't plan to speak at a later item? Hearing none, I'll move on to the first item on the agenda. A violation hearing, Papagino's Incorporated. Date of violation, alleged violation, June 13th. And the violation alleged is Mass General Laws, Chapter 138, Section 34. Usual way we conduct these violation hearings is to open them, which I've just done, and then I will read the charge. That the police department has brought to us. This is dated August 18th from Chief Casper to the Northampton License Commission. Hey, this is Hugo's. Where is it? Here it is. It's Papagino's. Okay. This is a hearing. This is actually a memo from Chief Sinkowitz, dated June 19th. And it was as a result of a compliance sweep conducted by the NPD, citywide underage liquor service compliance sweep. A violation is alleged here involving Papagino's on King Street. And it's, we have, I won't read through the whole thing because the police will recapitulate this, but we do have a allegation that on that date, June 13th, 2015, an underage person was served at Papagino's. So that constitutes the alleged violation. This time, what I would like to do is to ask anybody who expects, since this is a violation hearing, we swear in witnesses, anybody who expects to speak, to testify in this matter, would you please rise? I'll just ask you to raise your right hand and say that, do you affirm that all the statements you're about to give in this hearing are true to the best of your knowledge? Say, I do.
I do.
Thank you. The procedure for us is to hear from the department. So at this time, we'll hear a statement from whoever from the NPD wishes to address this, this violation.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Chief.
Your first time doing this in your present capacity, so okay. I'm happy to welcome you to the.
Thank you so much. Okay, as you said, it was part of a community compliance check that we were conducting along with the Northampton Prevention Coalition. We either checked or attempted to check all licensed establishments in the city. We had two violations that night. Papagino's was one of those violations. A 19-year-old male was provided with $20, went into the establishment, ordered a beer. The server, who was identified, I believe as Jessica, brought him the beer to the table and asked him for an ID at this time. He said, I don't have one, and she said, we'll remember to bring it next time. She then let him have the beer. He walked out, provided the beer to the officer that was outside. Those are the facts of the case.
Is there anyone else from the department who wishes to say
anything?
No,
the other officer, he's here on another matter.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else then, Chief?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now I'd like to hear from the licensee. Which Please identify yourself for the record.
I'm the general manager of Hubbard Jails.
Your name, please.
Tina Barbio, I'm sorry.
Okay. And can you address the charge that the chief has leveled at you?
That's what happened.
Okay. The employee charged with the violation, was there any sort of additional training after the day?
We have since certified our complete management team to certify.
Okay.
And we obtained a book on how to properly check IDs.
Okay. And your management team, how about the servers? How about the people who are the waitresses and waiters who are management team?
It's policy for the management team to serve.
I'm sorry?
It's policy for the management team.
To serve?
To provide service for alcohol.
So Ms. Rock was a member of your management team?
Yes.
Okay.
So the usual procedure then now would be for you to, using the tips training to when a customer orders an alcoholic beverage, if they're ordering, I assume they're servers then who aren't members of the management team.
Right, yeah.
So then one of you would come over and take that order, verify the age, and serve the customer. Do you have any other questions, Mary?
No, as long as the verification process has been updated and strengthened, I'll be satisfied.
I note that there haven't been any other violations at your location, at least within living memory, right? Okay.
That was the same situation before that we...
That was last month.
Yes.
Okay.
And in that situation, I would just bring to your attention that we did impose...
We need to go on violation first. Okay, anything else to add on here? Does anybody else wish to speak on this matter? Okay, hearing none then. Thank you. Nobody else wishes to speak on this violation? Okay, then I will close the public hearing for the, I'll take a motion to close the public hearing.
I'll also move.
Second, all in favor, aye.
Aye.
So the violation has been alleged by the department and acknowledged by the licensee. Make a motion. We find that the licensee is in violation of Chapter 138.
I'll second that.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, the violation having been found, the sanction, since there has been no other violation, and since, as you know, the earlier licensee who was charged in the same compliance suite, what was the sanction?
One day suspended.
Then,
Cindy, I'm right about that. I don't want to.
Yes, I think that's so. Yeah.
And in that situation, they admitted, verified that they had changed their process, and there was no past record. So we felt that giving them a chance to avoid the one day sanction was fair.
Okay. Let me just note before then we. Impose a sanction that the department, the police department, and the license commission, and in fact, the entire community takes underage service very seriously. That's why we do these compliance checks. There have been cases where there have been repeated violations of this, and a heavier sanction was imposed on people. But since you have acknowledged the violation and acknowledged also taking additional steps to avoid future problems like this underage service of alcohol, and since you have had, you're not a repeat offender of this statute, we would impose a sentence that you don't have to serve barring any future violations within the period we prescribe. So if nothing else happens, then the sanction we're about to impose would not be served. So saying that, then I move that we suspend the license of Papagino's for 1 day, but do not execute the suspension for a period of 6 months. Pending no further violations, the suspension will not have to be served.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
So again, within 6 months, if there's no further violations of this matter, then we do keep a record of all violations of where we have found a violation and impose a sanction. But at this point, all we will say is for 6 months, make sure that there's no further violation, or else we will have to suspend your license for a day. Of course, any further violations of anything else or any new problems that come up would have to be heard anew in any event. So, okay. Thanks, Ms. Barbieri, and thank you, Chief. Okay, moving on then to the next item on the agenda. Violation hearing, Bashir Incorporated, doing business as Hugo's on Pleasant Street. The date of the alleged violation was August 9th, 2015. And I have a memo from, sorry, from Chief Casper, requesting a violation hearing for an incident on August 9th at the Hugo's. The routine liquor establishment check at that address at 3:04 a.m. Established that people at the bar were consuming alcoholic beverages in violation of closing hours. And the violations alleged are one count of violation of rule number 4 from the proposed rules for extended hours in the city of Northampton. No alcoholic beverages shall be served to patrons after 1:40 a.m. The closing time is 2 a.m. Last call is at 1:40. Number two, two counts of violation of rule number 5 from the rules for extended hours. All patrons must vacate the premises no later than 2 a.m. No agent or employee of a licensee present for cleanup shall remain on the premises after 2:45 a.m. This is standard in the city. We rarely have any problems with this. So those are the two violations alleged here at this time. Chief, would you or one of your officers like to speak to this?
Good
if you could just identify yourself for the record, Sergeant.
Absolutely. Sergeant Greg Crepto.
Hmm?
Where's people?
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, did we swear you in for the other one? No.
No, I'm sorry.
Let me ask the people who expect to speak on this violation alleged that Hugo's also stand and we'll do the same thing you did. So. And anybody else who expects to speak on this matter, could you just raise your right hand? Can you affirm that all the statements you're about to give in this hearing are true to the best of your knowledge? Say I do.
I do.
Thank you. Okay, so the hearing on Hugo's continues. Sergeant, could you identify yourself for the record?
Absolutely. Sergeant Greg Crepto, over the overnight shift 11-7, and my capacity right now is patrol sergeant. So basically on Sunday morning, August 9th, at around 3:04 in the morning, I was driving down Pleasant Street. The lights inside of Hugo's were on. I noticed there were people inside. One was sitting at the bar. The other one was standing on the opposite side of the bar. It didn't look like anyone was cleaning up or restocking. I pulled in to the parking lot adjacent to the building. I walked in the doorway and I observed one of the gentlemen drinking from a 16-ounce can. As soon as I knocked, I observed like a short dialogue between the two, and the can disappeared off the bar. The other thing I also want to mention is that one of the gentlemen was smoking inside the bar. I went inside and inquired where the can went. I looked around and I finally realized it was tossed on the opposite side of the bar in an attempt to hide it from me. I identified the two gentlemen. They were cooperative. Both had mass licenses in hand. The gentleman sitting at the bar drinking was identified as James Zaleski, and the bartender was identified as William Lambie. And those are essentially advice.
And so this was at 3:04 when you first noticed the violation. After that, was the bar closed up promptly?
Yes, it was.
Okay. Were you present?
Yes, it was.
Do you have any questions for Sergeant Corrento?
No, it's been very clear. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. At this time, is there anyone else, Chief, from the department, who wishes to speak on this?
No.
Licensee, care to address the alleged violation?
Hello. My name is Christopher Wentz. I'm the manager of Hugo's. I have a written statement. If I could ask you guys while we're here,
please.
Prepared by myself and the owner, Jerry Cochran. Explains our current actions as far as the violation.
Right. Do you want to read this, or because one of us needs, if you're submitting it, I should read it into the record.
Would you read it into the record?
We accept at face value the report of Sergeant Corrector that one of our employees was in the bar on August 9th, 2015, beyond the 2:45 a.m. allowed time, and that there was also another person there who was not an employee, and that both of these circumstances are violations. We accept the report that there was a beer can on the counter. This suggests that the beer may have been served after 1:40 a.m. However, we have no way of knowing if that beverage was served after that time, nor does the officer who observed the can on the counter have any way of knowing when that drink was served, and therefore no one can be sure whether any violation occurred that was additional to the other two violations. We take any violation of the rules and regulations of the License Commission very seriously. After receiving the License Commission letter detailing the police report on about August 27th, 2015, and after investigating the occurrence, we made the decision to terminate the employment of the bartender in question, which we did on September 4th. All of our employees had been made aware of the rules of the License Commission for extended hours before this incident. All remaining employees have since been instructed again as to the rules. Termination of the employee in question is to send a forceful message that we are serious about following those rules. Proposed rules for extended hours states that, quote, the Northampton Police Department may seek the immediate termination of extended hours during the trial period for individual licensees or for all licenses based upon credible evidence of an increased threat to public safety or order resulting from extended hours. We hope that our actions to address our violations, including termination of the employee involved and re-education of our remaining employees, will mitigate any increased threat to public safety. We ask that any penalty assessed be lenient in this case, given that this is a first offense. We have what we would consider to be an exemplary record, as to following both state liquor laws and the rules set by the License Commission. Our business and livelihood of our remaining employees are economically dependent on the privilege of having extended hours. This is submitted by Gerard Paquin, President of Bashir Incorporated, DBA Hugo's Cafe, and signed by Christopher Wentz, manager of Hugo's Cafe. Do you want a copy of this?
Yeah, I put it in an exhibit, I think.
Yeah. She's the lawyer. She's on these sorts of things. Thank you, Mr. Wentz. Is there anything then that you'd like to add to the statement that I just read?
Well, an apology to Sergeant Corrupta.
Thank you.
We sat down that night. We had other things to do that night. And we're very vigilant about that. And I do appreciate that the Northampton Police Department checks on my employees and the business at night for compliance checks. I have two women that work late at night at the bar, and I'm not always there. So it is appreciative what they do. I feel badly about what happened with this incident. So.
All right. Well, it seems that you were acknowledging the violation then in this case. The matter of smoking, by the way, isn't ours to judge as the Board of Health. Whether the service of the beer was made after the 1:40 a.m. cutoff, you say can't be established. I'm not sure what we can do to establish that at this point, but note that you've made that point. Do you have other questions for Mr. Mason?
No, I just simply note for the record that the licensee has accepted responsibility for the violations that were brought by the police department and has apologized, and I appreciate that.
And Chief or Sergeant Krepta, is there anything else that the department would like to add on this?
No, nothing further.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on this matter? Then I'll move we close the public hearing.
I'll second that.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
The violation has been alleged and acknowledged. I note again for the record that and I can't never recall a violation of Hugo's in my time on the board. So that being noted, would you like to discuss, we need to vote on whether a violation in fact has occurred.
Also move.
Okay, you should specify.
I will make a motion that we find that the alleged violations did occur and were admitted to by the licensee.
Okay, those are the extended hours for service rule number 4 and 105. I'll second that. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, a violation has been found. Sorry, let me continue then. Would you like to address the matter of possible sanction?
Well, Bill, you've been on the commission a long time. I've been on a much shorter period of time. And if you say that this licensee has never been before us for bad actions or misbehavior or violations, whatever you want to call it, I certainly would defer to a one-day suspended violation.
Yeah, noting the employee in question had been fired. I think that I know what that means if that's what happened, and know that the what that means for the way the business is managed in the general sense. So, given that the one-day suspension, you said suspended for 6 months.
Yes.
Before. Mm-hmm. I would agree with that. So is that a motion?
I will make that. I will transform that into a motion.
I will second that then, the motion being that Hugo should be found in violation, therefore the license to serve alcohol should be suspended for 1 day, execution of that suspension shall be deferred for a period of 6 months. Barring any further violation, the suspension will not be served. So so it's been moved and seconded. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So it's essentially the same sanction as we just applied in the other case. Again, if there's no further violations within the 6 month period, this will not have to be served. If there are, it would, plus any additional sanctions on whatever new violation that would come before us within that 6 month period. So, that concludes this matter, so thank you all. Thank you, Chief and Sergeant. Chief, could I ask you one question?
Sure, thank
you. Scheduling questions. Could you make it time to get to the end? It's been too long since you've been on the line. Just pop it.
Service the last couple of meetings.
We appreciate it. You folks don't have to stay.
They do, they have another request.
Oh, you do? Sorry, I didn't even look at the agenda. See, I got here so late, I didn't have a chance to look at it. Sorry. Look, and there it is. No, we didn't, no. It's number seven, is application for change of manager, Doyle's Package Store. Proposed manager, Stephen Shea. Is somebody here from Doyle's? Hi there.
Hi, I'm Steve Shea.
I'm sorry?
I'm Steve Shea.
Hi.
Welcome.
Thank you.
You would be the manager. Was your father the manager before this?
Yes.
Okay. And checks in that we have signed 443. Do we need a motion on 443?
You just have to remind him that the PDCC, if this change hasn't been approved by the ABCC prior to renewals, what is the situation?
Right. Because the change of manager is going, and this will be the same for Papagino's, the change of manager is going through in October. If the ABCC hasn't approved it, you'll get your renewal information under the previous manager name, and then we'll just change it after that, but they'll approve it once they approve it.
So the new license will still say Timothy E. Shea,
but
you'll administratively change it?
Once it comes through.
Or will I get a second copy?
I will send you the right copy as soon as it's approved by the ABCC if it gets approved.
We never can predict how long they'll take. That's the problem.
Just curious, Mr. Shea, have you worked it? What was your father's store?
Yeah, I've been working with my father since I was about 13, but with regards to Doyle's Package Store, I've worked part-time there since 1996, and I'm TIPS trained beginning in 1996.
And I think you've appeared before us before, haven't you, Steve?
With regard to a zoning issue, 101 Street,
that's
Forest,
right.
The new building.
You're right.
Yeah, Emily Forest. Yes.
No, I remember seeing your father in here over the years. Oh, just over the years.
Yeah, over the years. I'm sure he's made his impression.
So you know this story, you know how it works.
I didn't really finish. From 2011, I've been with 84 Maple full time. So from 1996, I worked part-time. From 2011, I've been full-time in the business. Various businesses included that, actually.
Are all your family's businesses under 84 Maple Incorporated, or just the package store?
84 Maple is mainly the package store. We also operate a laundromat, and I do management for the commercial residential properties through 84 Maple. Properties are owned by the Tempe Shipyards.
Right. Do you still, I'm sorry, this has nothing to do with this. You still own the old Murdoffs there?
Yeah.
I don't know.
You just love to know everything about town, don't you?
I'm sorry. It's completely irrelevant. Strike that. I have no further questions for Mr. Shea.
I think Mr. Shea will be a fine man.
I'll make a motion then that we approve the change of manager and also the execution of sign form 43 for the ABCC.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, now you're up. Item 8, application for change of manager, Papagino's. Ms. Barbieri. So, the manager before was whom?
I'm sorry?
Who was the manager before?
Panda.
Could you say that last name again just for my old ears?
Nogum. I don't know if I'm saying it properly.
How do you spell it?
What?
Kendra Meland was her name, M-E-L-H-A-N-D.
Should be on our records anyway.
The last approved manager was Charles Lewison.
Oh, that could be.
We had your paperwork changed. I emailed Frank, I believe.
Yeah.
And so we didn't ever have Kendra as there, so.
Okay, let's just take Kendra off. Okay.
She was in, right?
She was never an approved manager, so.
This came up briefly before, right? No, never mind. Doesn't matter. Okay, all right, I see that we have all the paperwork here. The ADCC will have to approve it. Have you managed a restaurant with service of alcohol before or been involved in management at another one?
This is the first Willa Hall. I've been with Papa John's for 8 years.
8 years, okay. And I have no other questions, Ms. Marty, are you?
I just want to make sure your tip's trained and certified.
Yes.
Okay. Just want to make sure. That's all.
Okay. Then I'll accept the motion.
I'll make a motion that we accept the change of manager to Ms. Barbieri. And do we have a
Form 43.
Form 43 also approved.
Okay. I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right, thanks.
Thank you very much.
Item number 9, application for short-term wine and malt license, Silverscape Design. This event is scheduled for November 27th, 28th, 29th, noon to 5 p.m. Hi, you're Jane Merrill?
Yes.
Hi, welcome.
Thank you.
Tell us what you're going to do on those 3 days.
It's actually a customer appreciation party for 3 days. So we run sales, we give part of our sale proceeds to the United Way those 3 days. And we serve champagne from 12 to 5. Actually, Spoleto serves the champagne, mm-hmm. but we take out the license.
Okay. And so you're doing 3 days, noon to 5.
Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Who will be serving the alcohol?
Spoleto's.
Okay, so they're servers?
Yes.
I have no other questions for this meeting.
No, I think this is a long and hallowed tradition.
Yes, it is. It is almost a 30-year tradition.
I was going to say, not that I've been over there drinking your champagne, but I've been aware of it for a long time. I don't have any further questions. I'll make a motion to approve the application for short-term wine and malt license by Silverscape Design, Inc., for the holiday celebration sales event.
Second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Item number 10, application for short-term wine and malt license rain date, JJ's Tavern. Is there somebody here from JJ's?
No, we advised him he didn't need to be here because he requested it last time and he said it just needed to be publicly announced.
Okay. All right, then we have an application for that we already approved, I take it, for a short-term wine and malt license. They have a rain date in case things go wrong, or maybe things already did go wrong, for October 11th. I'll make a motion that we accept this rain date.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Item 11, application for short-term wine and malt, Academy of Music. Allison, how are you?
Good, how are you?
We have comedy show November 20th, Moth main stage November 21st, Signature Sounds concert November 27th, and the Brandy Carlisle concert November 28th. And is here, and you're requesting a fee waiver as well.
Yes.
Do you have any questions for Allison?
No. She's Brandy Carlisle.
She's a pretty popular young folk singer.
Kind of.
I know
sounds
who
like
she
a
is.
Good
I know who she is.
Yeah.
I've heard her song.
I'm a little folk. I was like, yes.
I do know. Anyway, which is also irrelevant. So I'll make a motion that we approve with a fee waiver the four applications for the Academy of Music for the dates on their applications.
I'll second that.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Allison, I have them
if you want them. Oh, perfect.
Oh, right. There's a song about Carolina.
Yes.
It's about North Carolina, for a person's name.
I think it's me.
Are you talking about James Taylor or something?
No, it's another song. It's more than one song about Carolina.
Okay.
Okay, next item on the agenda is application for an entertainment license for Brew Practitioners for 36 Main Street in Florence. Could you just identify yourself for the record, please?
Yes, I'm Sally.
I'm owner, general manager, general counsel.
Brew Practitioners, 36 Main Street.
Right, so it's right in the cafe foundation courtyard. Right behind Tranquility, well, old Tranquility Day Spa building, across from Cooper's Corner.
Right. Do we? Is there?
We approved them for a pouring license last month.
We did. Oh, okay. That's why. That's why I'm looking.
Puzzled.
This puzzled look on my face. Yes. Okay. Okay. So you have a pouring license, and you'd like the entertainment license. Then tell us just a little bit more about how the entertainment will be set up, and you know. How it will last and what sort of.
Okay, so we have several different, well, we have a rather large area with limited occupancy. So it's a very tall building, so sound wise, I believe that it won't be a nuisance to the other parties. So the type of bands that we have, anyway, so my venue is 2,000 square feet. We have 16 foot ceiling up to the rafters, probably another 10 up to the actual glass on the very top of the building. So it's very spacious. It's an open square brownstone. Inside is housed a brewery, a small brewery, three barrel system. We were approached, in particular, this coming Saturday, we were approached by the local Celtic band Wild Time, and they wanted to do, they have a five piece acoustic Irish band that they would like to do for our grand opening we're having this Saturday. They are, from what I understand, pretty enmeshed in the local Florence community as well as Williamsburg. And we also have, was also approached by a couple of other bands to do similar limited sets for a couple of hours. So I actually have not had to reach out far into the community before they sought me for some space. Also, we have a band, True Jackie, that is out of West Springfield that has roots in Florence as well, that has a blossoming all-female band that they are, I guess, trying to develop. So they would also like to play an hour set on Saturday and then have the female developing band do three or four songs just as, because they haven't developed a full set list yet. So we stated that that would be fine in a limited duration. So that would be during the day from 2 to 4-ish. and then the Celtic band would be from 5:30 to 8. So that's just one day in particular. In regards to other events, we have a standing bear band approached us, who is a local band who has done sets throughout the community, as well as, I believe, Turner's Falls. They have somewhat of a, I don't know what you want to call it.
That's okay, you don't need to describe.
Okay, so what they've asked is that they're going to do a documentary of their band, and they would like to start first in our facility because of the historic nature of the building. And then they're going to move on to a couple other sites. They have a photographer that's going to be following along with them. They have a group of troubadours that's going to be a part of the documentary, and a couple of artists as well. And they want to just exhibit the artist community in Western Massachusetts, specifically Florence, East Hampton, North Hampton area. In regards to others, so those are just particular types of things that we would like to do. In regards to other events, we have, we're only open 4 days a week for limited hours. So those
what are the hours?
The hours are Thursday and Friday, 5 to 9, Saturday 1 to 9, Sunday 1 to 5. So those are our listed hours of operation.
Right, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday?
Right.
Okay.
So
to 9 o'clock is when
you're right. And right now I'm the one that's managing it, so I don't know. So we also do have plans for private events as well. So I am also among the several boards, and in those boards we have corporate affiliations that we do events for private parties, fundraising, that type of thing. We were donated a piano from the Hartsburg School that we intend to use for like chamber orchestras for particular private events, whether it be like a red shoe type ball thing, or a or silent auctions, things like that. We also, I hope to have in collaboration with the High Bar across the way. She is a concert pianist, so it would be nice to be able to do some community events in conjunction with that. So we have several things in mind, as well as I am a huge fan of education, arts education, and so we're hoping to be able to work with the music school to be able to bring in some budding artists. It's a small venue and a small area, so we're not going to be able to do anything large. There's not going to be 100 people in this place. We have a limited occupancy of 40.
That was my next question. What is your occupancy permit at this point?
Right, 49. We have seats for 24 inside. We do have a patio that seats 20. But overall, it's just a small artist community. We just want to have the capacity to be able to entertain certain fundraisers, certain artist groups that want to come in, or like for Halloween, we want to do a hippie Halloween, hoping to, during the day, to be able to have a magician, seeking a magician to come in for the kids to do a little show on the patio, and then that night have the hippie band that's approached us that wants to play. Oh, and one more, they want to have a community benefit. I've been approached like this week with several people that want to do things that are all awesome, and that's one of the reasons why we chose Florence, because it's right there in the little main street, mm-hmm. and all the businesses are working in conjunction with one another, and it's just a wonderful facility.
The license you get is just for the premises. We're given a pouring license for, so
right.
Does that include the patio?
Yes.
It does, okay. And you know, Cindy, note the hours on the license beyond what she is applying for here.
I'll get your license to you tomorrow. After
what's the question? I didn't hear
that. Oh, no.
I just did the generic entertainment license, but the license that you're applying for is just for the hours that you're open for the entertainment license. So I'm
and also private events, which will be probably not held during my normal operating hours. And those I really can't anticipate until I actually have them. So, for example, we may have a Christmas party. I have a lot of corporate affiliations. So if they want to have a Christmas party at my venue, that I would have them come in, and if they want to have a chamber orchestra or a concert pianist, that I would like to be able to do that without having to.
We need to give you entertainment license for your public events there, and for the hours that you expect to use it.
Okay.
So,
well, on my website, I do have listed that on Monday through Wednesday, I do have open for special events. So that would still be considered operating hours. They would be paying me, I guess, for whatever
if you're renting a hall, then no, that would be...
No. It's my facility. It's all my facility. I'm not going to be open for the public to come in on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, but I would still be using it for private parties, and that would be a function.
The question is private versus public. And if she's charging people money for events, I don't think that falls within, quote, a private function.
No, it's the same thing as if you had a band at the Garden House or the hotel or something like that.
So I think she does need...
They have licenses that cover all those things. A private event, if you're letting your premises to another party to have something go on there and includes entertainment, then you say you're allowing it to use it.
Well, but I would also be serving as well, so I just wouldn't.
So she needs to expand it to Monday through Wednesday, whatever you're putting on your website and telling people that you're available.
Right.
Right.
For people to come in and basically use your premises and be served, etc. We need to have that covered under the entertainment license. So Monday through Wednesday, what hours are you telling people it's conceivably available?
I haven't actually put the calendar up, but if they wanted to have a lunch, dinner, party, I doubt they don't have entertainment for that, but noon to 9, I guess.
Okay, I would just suggest you be as flexible as you think
right.
you may need, because
right.
again, you don't.
Well, definitely, I would think noon until closing. Considering I'm at the brewery, I don't know if there'd be any breakfast.
You close at 9.
Right.
What's that? And
sorry.
You close at 9 every time that you're.
Right.
You
so we close, meaning that
and
I'm not letting anyone else in the door. There may be still patrons in the facility, but I'm not.
Yeah.
It's my hours.
If you don't have a 2 a.m. closing time, you have a 1 a.m. closing time, then everybody has to be off the premises, as you know, by 1 a.m. no matter what.
Right.
And last service of alcohol until 4:40 a.m. For our purposes, what you describe as a private event isn't. It still comes under this entertainment license. It's a public thing that has to be licensed. So, Cindy, what would be easiest here for you to revise the thing based on some further feedback you'll get from the applicant?
Sure.
How do you want to do this?
All of our entertainment licenses have said the same thing.
They'll do.
Yeah.
All right. Well, then.
I can just make it the generic one, or I can say that if you guys want to.
I'm happy to make it the generic one.
Can you read the language from the generic one?
To be conducted on Sundays between the hours of 1 p.m. and 1 a.m. and to be conducted on Monday through Saturday between the hours of 8 a.m. and 1 a.m.
That gives you plenty of coverage, and I think that we would prefer that we do the generic in that way. You can limit your business
right.
as you see fit.
Right.
And you don't have to come back and ask for expansion.
Okay, and that's perfect by me. And that's our in-house policies can be a little more strict than our governing the list. That's usually the way we handle those things anyway. Just
right.
for our safety's sake.
All right. What you're getting is an entertainment license for for the normally permitted hours in the city of Northampton. And if you change the nature of your business, if you start to have entertainment that starts to push up to 1 a.m., where you're located, I can anticipate, not that it will happen, but it happens here sometimes that neighbors will come and challenge the noise levels that you're promoting. So if you plan to change the nature of this, the hours significantly, if you plan to bump up against the wee hours of the morning there, I suggest that you have an entertainment license. If we grant this, that would give you that right, but I suggest that you let us know what you're doing, let the police know what you're doing, talk to your neighbors, because if a noise complaint comes.
Oh, completely. I understand
that. That's what happens. So right now you're saying 9 o'clock, that's it.
Right, and that later hour is part of our business model.
We would give you a license, but do keep an eye on that.
For sure.
Because of where you're located.
For sure. Thank you so much.
I'll make a motion. We approve the entertainment license for
Brew Practitioners LLC. I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Cindy, so I need to come back tomorrow?
Yeah, I know, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I'm always here.
Thank you, Cindy. I'll see you tomorrow.
Item 13, application for short-term wine and malt license for Smith College Dining Services.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Hi, and could you identify yourself for the record, please?
Hi, my name is Patty Hens, the Associate Director of Dining Services.
Hens.
Patty Hens.
Hens.
Hens, H-E-N-T-Z.
So tell us what you're planning to do on October 24th.
The seniors have requested a wine and cheese party at the museum, but they did not want to pay for it as a class, so they want us to sell the alcohol. We don't have a license for that, so that's why we're here today.
Okay, and this would be at 30 Belmont Average Building, is that?
No, that's where we, our office is. It's actually at the Tryon atrium in the museum, and I apologize if I didn't fill that out correctly.
We need to know the actual premise where you'll be serving.
It's actually at the Smith College Museum in the atrium. They call that the Tryon atrium.
Okay.
Smith College.
T-R-Y-O-N.
The art
museum of art, is that?
Yes.
Okay.
So, so you'll have the seniors have a little party there in the atrium of the art museum, and who will your servers be?
I have two servers listed. We have two of our catering servers, and all our bartenders are tip certified. Kimberly Osborne is listed as a server, and I believe Kathy Santos. And I think what the student's idea was is that it's during family weekend, so I think they want their parents to come. So that's how it got to this.
So their parents will come, they'll be served?
I think they're like sort of, I don't know exactly how many parents, but they're planning on, you know, it is during family weekend, so parents could stop by.
Sure. And given that some seniors in college may not have reached the age of 21, you'll have something in place for age verification?
Yes, we check IDs on a separate table and we wristband because it's easier for the bartenders with the wristband, so we do that.
That's certainly sufficient.
Okay.
Okay. Do you have any other questions?
No.
Okay.
I'll make a motion that we approve their application for short-term license for the family weekend event.
Okay, I'll second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
I have a check too for it.
I can't give you the license
yet.
I can take that for you now, and then I can get it to you tomorrow.
Sure.
The address, though, and the license will be for the museum.
Oh.
Not your office.
Yes, okay. Sorry about that.
It's okay.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Item 14, application for short-term wine and malt license for Gold Foods in Hampton. I don't have a date. Hi, welcome.
Clem Clay.
Clem Clay. Welcome, Clem. Okay, so this is for October 25th, noon to 4 p.m. at 245 Main Street.
Oh, no, I apologize. I also filled that out incorrectly.
What is the premise of the liquor will be
217 Spring Street in Florence.
What is that?
That's our mailing address. That's where the location of Crimson and Clover Farm.
What is it exactly? Is it a
organic?
Is that farm? There's a farm building there or something like that?
Yeah, there's a barn, and it's a 120-acre farm that Grofey Northampton owns, but we lease that particular portion of it to Crimson and Clover Farm.
Okay, you said 217 Spring Street in Florence. Okay.
So the alcohol is actually going to be served in the barn, is that correct?
No, it'll be served under a tent outside the barn.
Describe the premise there, the tent and the building and the...
So there's
you plan for traffic and who's coming and that sort of thing.
Sure. It's a farm festival that we haven't done in 3 years, but it's very similar to the last one we did in 2012, with the exception that the Parks and Rec Department has let us do parking at Florence Fields, which wasn't fully developed at that time. So I don't know if you're familiar with that area of Meadow and Spring Streets in Florence, but patrons will be able to park at Florence Fields on Meadow Street and walk. There's sort of a little back walk to the farm. It's a very short walk, about 5 minutes, and up onto the farm. So other than disabled parking, there won't be any parking at that Spring Street address. It'll just be for vendor access if disabled.
And the alcohol will be served inside this, under this tent?
Yeah, so right near the barn that you can see if you were to drive by that address on Spring Street.
And who are your servers?
We have a will be tip certified bartender. One of my board members, Susan Pincus, who I thought was tip certified, and it turns out she's a part-time professional bartender, but because there's not a legal requirement in Massachusetts, she's committed to getting that certification in the coming week, but she makes most of her money bartending.
So you just have the one bartender for this event?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, if you think she can handle it.
She thinks she can. Okay. So, she's a pro. And we're only going to have, one keg each of cider, hard cider, and beer. And so, she thinks that that's going to be manageable. She does events like this most weekends.
Okay. And your distributor is Artifact LLC?
Yeah, so that's the distributor for the cider. They do have the Farmer Winery Distributor's License.
Right.
And Provisions is providing the drop-off location and the communication for us with Brewmaster Jack, which is the provider of the beer. I'm waiting for them to give me the distributor's license information for them. So we're actually not buying it from Provisions. Provisions is just sort of making the connection.
They're whited out here on the
because
forest.
They're not on the approved licenses for
right.
Short term.
Because they're
so
retail.
We have to get it directly from the wholesaler.
Right.
Right. So we will be buying it directly from that wholesaler. I just at the time I had to submit the application, I didn't have that information. So I'll be providing that. If you make it a condition of the license, I'll have that as well as the tip certification for Susan Davis.
As long as the distributor is on the list, that's required by law.
They must be.
To
they couldn't distribute the provisions. So.
And I note that your tax exempt certificate is in here, so you're not a profit, so any proceeds can go to your organization.
I have one question. That is, in situations where there's only one bartender and an open air venue, like a tent, do you have someone who's going to be manning the entrance to the tent? What I'm talking about is people leaving with containers of alcohol.
I see what you're saying.
Because I don't see how she can basically serve the alcohol from the kegs and also watch for folks. Our concern is not so much ours, it's the state's and the ABCC regs.
Right.
They don't want people taking open containers of alcohol out of the venue where it's being served.
No, that's an excellent question. And I don't, because of the very open air format, it's a farm festival. People will be able to wander around and participate in different activities. It's going to be mostly family oriented, but in the event that somebody did attempt to do that, I think that the best thing that I could suggest that we would do, if it would be make sense to you, would be to station somebody on the return to the parking area to monitor for that. So we plan to have somebody at the parking area to sort of greet people and make sure they're walking on the right path anyway. I was had not intended on having somebody there at the end of the event, because I figured people would know their way back, but it would be easy enough to add a shift of responsibility to ensure that as people are headed back, any open containers are dumped out or taken away. The containers will be, mm-hmm. I mean, there won't be cans or bottles, but if somebody were had a mug of that kind, I think that's the best way that we could ensure that we address that issue.
Just secure the perimeter. That's what I'd say. I mean, you know what to do.
Yeah.
People can take containers of alcohol off the premises that we're licensing for this one-day license.
Yeah.
You'll have a bartender there, but you'll need people who are responsible.
Right.
To make it. It's these things generally work out if people know that they have this responsibility here. So we're just
the liability.
We're
that
just
you're taking
telling,
on.
Which perfect sense. I don't want to take any extra liability.
Yeah, we're just telling you. Yeah,
your security people, whatever. Somebody needs to make sure that people aren't coming out of the tent and wandering all over.
It's not just liability. It's also a violation of statute too.
Right.
It's involved here. So use your judgment. Keep it. What Elaine's saying is these open air venues, depending on Grow Food Northampton doesn't sound like the Hobart Hoedown, but you need to take all reasonable steps you can to secure the perimeter.
Right. And so does it make sense to you that since there's really only one logical path off the premises and back to parking to focus on that? To me that seems
it sounds like that. Yes, right. Yes, do that.
That sounds workable.
How many other people, I'm sorry, did you say besides you and the woman being your bartender are sort of the organizers of this or the responsible
parties?
We'll
probably have 25 to 30 volunteers working at all times.
Okay.
Deputize
some of them,
right.
Give them this warning that we're giving you is that, you have to serve only and allow consumption only on the licensed premises here, which is basically this parking lot and this tent. And so keep it to that and tell your other volunteers that's what you need. Find a few that will say we have to be responsible for the service of alcohol here. Here are the rules. We need to enforce them. So
right.
that would be enough.
Great.
Okay. Okay, other questions here? I'll move we approve this for 217 Spring Street for October 25th for Grow Food Northampton.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
And good luck.
Thanks.
Can we have one other item?
Said there was a last minute new business thing.
What are we saying? Is that this call is here for?
Telecom?
Okay, so before we go to the rest of the stuff.
Yeah, let's go out of sequence and get this gentleman out of here.
That's what I was
doing.
Okay. This is an application for a farm winery license, so farmers markets and agricultural events. Outlook Farm Spirit, doing business as Outlook Farm Winery. You're from West Hampton. You want to do it at the Farmers Market on Gothic Street on Saturdays. I note that you have your MBA here, certificate, farm winery license. You've gotten the fee. We do have the MDAR. It's right here, right?
They are working on it.
What is this?
That's the MDAR for that they are a farm winery?
What's that? That should be the ABCC permit?
No, I have the agriculture. Oh no, it is the ABCC. You're right. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So MDR is working on it today and said they'd get it to me by tomorrow, so this is a pending receipt of that.
Okay, all right. So whatever we give you here will be pending receipt of the MDR. So you'll be pouring at the farmer's market from 7 a.m. to 1 p.m. on Saturdays.
And it's just retail sales for off-premises, so no pouring or tasting.
No pouring, okay. All right, and according to the application, this is for May 2nd through November 14th, 2015.
That's just the general farmer's market season.
That's the farmer's market
okay.
season.
Yeah, so
October. The license
will say. Are we renewing these automatically the next when the farmers markets get back up?
So they have to every year.
They always have to come back.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So
this will allow you just to go to November.
Yeah. Well, we just got our permit.
Through November.
We're new.
Okay.
So.
All right. So the rest of this month and first 2 weeks of November.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we're deciding if we want to go to winter.
The license will reflect the right intake.
We have winter Tuesday in Florence one. We're just going to see how this one goes and see about going. We've been a part of this one for years. So.
Okay. All right. I'll make a motion we approve a license to sell at farmers markets and agricultural events for Outlook Farm, the farmers market in Northampton on Saturdays, pending receipt of the MDAR.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. So once I receive that, I just get it to you and stop by.
And there's a $50 fee.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I'm back. I knew I shouldn't rely on my memory. I looked it up and it's 215 Spring Street. The Crimson and Clover address.
Thank you.
I think 3 years ago our poster said 217, and that's why I was in my head, but the address probably hadn't been formatted. Do you need to reopen it or?
No, we just need the right address.
Okay. That's why I went and checked on my way out just to be sure.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Discussion of one-day entertainment license process. Okay. We had a brief conversation about this. So
Can I speak to that really quickly?
You have the floor.
We got some opinion from the city solicitor, and at this point my recommendation would be to put it off because the hope was that we could have the mayor grant you guys the approving process ability.
Giving us authority. He doesn't feel we have authority to.
But he can't do that, so it's got to go through the mayor anyway at this point. So in that office, we're going to take care of it. So I think it needs to be at the table here. So this needs to come up.
My understanding of the statute and ordinance is that we can only give entertainment licenses to venues we've licensed for
alcohol.
Yeah. So if we're licensing, we're not the ones. The city issued a Sunday entertainment license. You remember that?
Yeah, I do remember that. But I'm sitting here. My concerns, which I will just speak because I think somebody should be speaking to it, is people saying they want to have an entertainment license for a party. You were just talking about Hobart. I mean, we could end up with some real.
We're not giving licenses for parties.
Well, I was just saying some of the people that, if we're looking at here, this. The old Iris photo, this is the one that Cindy had concerns about. The caller was labeling these events parties.
You know what? If Iris photo is not there anymore, there's no business there, and it's a private function, and people are coming, from an invite list.
There will be a business there. As soon as the business is established, he wants to be able to invite people.
But he needs a liquor license.
Okay. No, if he has.
He's not going to be serving alcohol, he says.
Right.
Why do we care about parties, though? Why should we care? I don't understand why.
Well, we can't. It's got to be through the mayor's office now. Yeah. So it's more that he wanted an entertainment license because he wanted to have entertainment, and there were parties, but they were to invite people off the street.
You can go ahead and did he even bring it up? He can go ahead.
Because he's a business. He's charging people money. You think of raves. I mean, talking about.
Yeah, yeah, but they're not serving alcohol. I know nothing in the law which requires him to have an entertainment license.
There's an amusement license. And so we're just going to compare it to other cities.
And see what people do when they come up.
There's a
amusement,
one day
amusement license. So if they don't serve alcohol, they have, this is a private guest list or something like that. And they have a string quartet, that's entertainment. It's like a quiet thing. They have to get a one-day entertainment license for that?
Well, it might not be a private guest list, because
it's a business. Say an art gallery is not going to serve, it's private business, okay? These folks down here on Main Street.
Don Muller.
Okay.
So they're not serving anything except crackers and cheese, okay? And they have a string quartet, so people walk around and look at the paintings, the overpriced paintings. Why should that need an entertainment license?
Why should that need to be regulated?
Exactly. The only reason we grant these things is that it's the service of alcohol, we regulate everything about that. You know, it's sort of the settled law, you know, not only in this state.
If I give somebody a cup of tea at my old law firm, you know, and right. I happen to have someone playing the violin, you know, really.
Yeah.
Anyway, but that's what you're basically saying is the mayor's office is going to look into that with Alan and
it doesn't have to be here.
Okay, fine. Okay, I think that's great.
I want to go on the record to say that this has nothing to do with us.
Right.
And if I'm, you know, if Alan wants to tell me, no, it does have to do with us, fine. You know, he'll tell me why.
Yep.
But I'm thinking, yeah. If somebody in a business, you know, has somebody playing the violin, I don't care. We don't care. We shouldn't care. We don't have any standing to care.
You are. Yeah. So. Okay. I think Cindy can help us. We'll deal with it if we have to, but
yeah,
right now
okay.
It doesn't appear we have to.
All right. So, I don't know if you want to pass up my rant to Alan.
I think he was in agreement with you.
Okay, good. Approval of 2015 renewal process contingent on inspections, outstanding taxes due. Anything new and different this year?
No, nothing. Next
okay.
year it'll be different. This year it's the same.
Okay. Do you want us to make a motion to approve it or just say go to it?
I think you need to make a motion according to Mary's notes.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve the conventional renewal process this year for licenses contingent upon inspections, outstanding taxes due.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, 2016 meeting schedule.
Okay, I took a look at it, and we usually customarily have one summer month. It's always been, I understand, August, that we don't have a meeting.
And then we almost always have an emergency.
I'm just going to throw out the novel suggestion that July 6th is not a great date, since July 4th almost the whole world goes on vacation that week. I'm wondering if Bill, you have any thoughts on maybe? Us having two meetings
yeah.
in June as opposed to.
Well.
Could we have one later in July so that there's one between July and August?
Yes, that would be
I'm just simply saying,
preference.
I know the week of July 4th,
right.
I will not be in town.
July 13th, say.
July 13th?
It's as bad as anything else, but I will come back for that. That's fine.
We could do it July 20th.
Let's do it July 20th.
Do we have any reason to suspect that's a bad date, Cindy?
No, I don't.
Okay.
All right, July 20th, 2016. And now, Cindy raised earlier when I was speaking with her the issue of whether Wednesdays are bad because there, I guess, were you feeling there'd been a lot of times when one or more of us weren't able to make the meeting? Is that what you're concerned?
Well, I just was kind of wanting to throw it out there again to see if there was a better time so that everyone could be here, so that we didn't have to worry about a quorum, but Wednesdays are good for you guys.
For me, Wednesdays, you know, I'm like an old horse, you know, going the same path from barn,
you know,
barn to the house.
Quasi-retired, so.
All right.
4 to 6. I like it earlier rather than.
Wednesdays is fine.
Okay.
And if you want to, you know, check in with Brian, feel free.
Check with him. But this is what we've done, and it works. It's worked for me. I rarely miss a meeting. I've missed a couple, but the last year and a half or so. But, using Wednesdays is fine.
So are we changing our past, as explained to me by you, Bill, past practice of not scheduling a regular meeting in August?
Yeah. We would have between June 1st and July 20th without a meeting. Things will back up. Is that going to be bother? Should we go back to the 13th for July? Can August or July 20th gives you a better spacing? July 20th.
Do you want to just keep them available, keep them on there so that the room is available for us if we want it, and then I can always change the calendar on the computer and publicly change it if we decide later in the year.
Okay,
so. I can see how things are going. But
so you want to put, what do you want to put there?
Do 7/13 then, and leave August there.
Okay.
And determine if it's needed.
Yeah, okay.
All right. More often than not, there's some meeting where we just have to gather for a special meeting in August. For one time there's a violation, a couple times there are people who are urgent for something or other. What did we do in August this time?
No, we had somebody come to us needing.
Yeah, just me and Brian, right?
Yeah.
Something needed something. Okay, all right, well, that's good. 18.
Do you want to vote on that, Cindy?
That's probably a good idea if you guys could vote on the schedule in the office.
As amended. So I'll make a motion that we approve the 2016 License Commission meeting schedule as amended to July 13th, 2016.
Okay, I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, approval of minutes from July 30th and September 2nd.
I don't have a spare copy, but I emailed them to you, and I don't know if you read them.
I wasn't here on September 2nd anyway, so.
The July one wasn't voted on either.
Oh, okay. What did we do July
30th?
I'm sorry, I didn't read them. Can we put this forward for the next time?
Because,
okay.
Again, Brian needs to be here. I'm not going to vote on the September 2nd.
Okay.
All right. Without him.
Just push that off. Okay. Proposed rules and regulation. So,
do you think we ought to push this forward also, so we have Brian's vote also?
I was really hoping to have it in only for renewals, because there are so many different, that we give those forms out to everybody, and it seems silly to me that it says proposed rules when all I'm really changing is.
Yeah, this is a lot of cleanup language, as I recall.
Yeah,
tell us if there's anything substantive here. But my recollection is that the rules for extended hours, we still have the proposed rules. You're right, and that was in the, that was all that was. We just never changed that language.
Yeah,
so
it's
all
clearly.
We've done, September 7, 2005. That's right. We voted to continue. Otherwise, it's the same. Okay. I'll move we approve this change to extended hours. We're not making a substantive change. We are just recognizing the fact these are no longer proposed, but they have been in
full force and effect
for years. Full force
and
effect for years. So I'll make that motion to approve these.
I'll second that.
All in favor, aye. Okay, rules and regulations of the Northampton License Commission. Okay. Okay, 2-2. We adopted this. You're saying we ratified this at the last meeting somehow?
No, I'm hoping to ratify it now.
This?
That's what we've already, okay, it's already been taking place.
Okay.
It's just.
So ratified at this meeting today, okay. In the case of short-term liquor license issued by the commission, for-profit organizations must specify non-profit organization. Again, we have been doing this. I remember when we adopted this matter, so do you have any objection to such a change? We are striking section 3-2 in its entirety and inserting the 2 a.m. closing rules as contained in our other separate thing. Okay. This incorporates the special rules for extended hours into the body of our regular rules and regulations. Do you have any objection to adopting this?
Just cleaning stuff up. I thought that's what I just voted on, but I guess I didn't.
No, this puts it into this.
Okay.
They're two separate documents.
Two separate documents. Okay. Okay. All right. Those are fine to me. I will move that we incorporate these changes, the addition of section 2.2 and replacing section 3-2 with the extended hours.
So I'll second that.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So that was it? Okay. All righty. Anything else?
Thank you, Cindy.
No, that was it.
Okay. Thank you.
I'll make a motion to adjourn the meeting.
I'll second. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Often we didn't make that motion.